Cincinnati jersey, all on the block. We get it in early. I'm in my Cincinnati hat.
Good day, and welcome to the Cincy Slangin Bearcat Podcast. I'm Coomer, joined as always by Hummer. Hummer, what's up, buddy?
The University of Kentucky can go to hell. CJ Fredrick is a Wildcat no more. The senior, 6'3", 185 pounds, hailing from Cincinnati, Ohio, is returning home. Is he a hometown hero? Is he replacing Jeremiah Davenport as our new hometown hero? Either way, this is a great day to be a Cincinnati Bearcat basketball fan.
Indeed it is. And I'm glad you did not bury the lead in this case. We are talking about it off the jump. I thought we were getting an F-bomb in the introduction. I got to be honest. The discipline impressed me. That's a seasoned vet who's now in season 5 of his podcasting career. That speaks volumes about your maturity and your growth as an individual. But Hummer, I'm glad you brought it up, and I'm glad it's how we're kicking off this podcast. The biggest news in Cincinnati Bearcat land is that Wes Miller has filled another spot via the transfer portal. CJ Fredrick, a transfer, as you alluded to, from the Kentucky Wildcats of Lexington, Kentucky, has decided to return to his roots of Cincinnati, Ohio, and play for Wes Miller. This is a player who actually was connected to Cincinnati before he decided to go to the Kentucky Wildcats a couple of years ago, and he has struggled with injuries. He was out for a season, and then he played throughout most season, hampered by injuries as well, which did impact some of the shooting splits. It definitely diminished what was a otherwise incredibly productive offensive career at Iowa during his first 2 years as a college basketball player. But there's no doubt in my mind, Hummer, this is a really good get for the Cincinnati Bearcats in terms of what he can do from a floor spacing standpoint. He is a dynamite shooter. 2 out of 3 seasons of his college career, he's been one of the best shooters in college basketball. He is a guy that has knocked down three-pointers at a 46-47% clip, 2 different seasons. If you look at his offensive readings and in terms of how his teams play when he's on the court, they're phenomenal. When you look back at that 2021 Iowa team, and a team that was loaded with Luke Garza, they were one of the most prolific offensive teams in the country. Who had the best offensive rating on the team? CJ Fredrick. It's a guy that has gravity, that makes a difference when he's on the court, and it's a very big get for Wes Miller.
It seems to be one of those, everybody has been clamoring for that go-to scorer. I think this is the perfect example of you not needing necessarily a go-to scorer. You need a guy who's going to be able to contribute in a positive way to the offense to open up opportunities for not only himself being off catch and shoot, but then, like you said, floor spacing, giving guys room to work. Someone's always going to have to be over there guarding CJ if he's down in the corner. Always got to keep an eye on him. So I think this is a really good piece that's going to make the offense be able to play a style that we like more than the selfish hero ball we've been used to. And considering the fact that, you know, there is other names that we're attached to, you know, Sima from Simas, Simas, Simas,
Simas Lukosius,
Simas.
That's what I'm going with. We're going Simas. I'm saying Simas Lukosius. Via Butler, who's still rumored to the Bearcats, but it's not final by any means. He's also connected to BYU. He's connected to Oklahoma State. I don't want to dive into him too much.
Who goes to BYU? I got a little antidote here about BYU because this happened to me. It didn't happen to me. It's something I observed. I was walking down the mean streets of Brooklyn, taking my daughter to school, and I saw this woman wearing a shirt that said sex, and it had a line crossed out through it. And it said the BYU Young Virgins Club. I couldn't help but think, like, what the hell is going on or not going on at BYU? Why do you want to go to BYU? You know, I heard nothing about, like, we want the college experience, the virtual. So why do you go to BYU for the college experience?
You know, I'm looking forward on this podcast episode. One of the things I wanted to get into was ranking reasons that players make decisions on where to go. In the transfer portal, are you going because of money? Are you going because of coach? Are you going because of the winning culture? Or are you going because of the what do you call it?
The absence of sex.
The absence of sex.
The BYU Maybe. Young Virgins Club.
For some people, Danny Ainge, maybe.
Well, more power to you if that's what you're going there for. But either way, back to the point that if we were talking about how, like, if we're trying to compare games, that he's more comparable to Jeremiah Davenport, doesn't bring a lot on the defensive end, you know, kind of maybe a little bit better of a shooter, but
well, maybe that's why I wanted
the game better.
That's why I wanted you to pump the brakes. I've done some video study of old Simus Lukosius, and I would pump the brakes on comparisons to Jeremiah Davenport. There are differences.
That is music to my ears.
The statistical profiles have some similarities, but in terms of where they're at in their development curve, where they're at in terms of how they play the game, how they see the game, and the types of plays they can make with the ball in their hands, quite different offensively.
Music to my ears. How's he fit in then after you've watched the tape? What are you seeing? If that lands with CJ, like, isn't this the fun part where we get to kind of like hypothesize?
I like hypothesizing, but here's the thing.
Oh, you're gonna take the Justin Williams stance, aren't you? You're not going to make predictions here.
You got to earn us talking about you in detail on a Cincy Slangin' podcast, okay? We're looking for a commitment. We're looking for you to put a ring on it before we go in depth on your game and how it fits with the Cincinnati Bearcats. Are we interested in him as a player and can see some optimism in terms of what he could add to the team? Absolutely. There's things. In fact, if you look in the Discord, I've sent it to a few people, some highlights of how he compares this game, who his favorite player is, things that he thinks he does well on the basketball court. It's out there. The videos are out there on YouTube if you're curious to dive in. But in terms of hearing it on this podcast, you got to commit first. I'm not giving you a full breakdown if you're someone who could just, you know,
I'm not gonna lie, I didn't watch any
slide into the abstinence of BYU eventually.
You just got to answer one question for me, then we can move on then from talking about this. All right, you ready? In any of these comparisons of his players at who he thinks he's like, did he pull the Mamadou Diarra and compare himself to Michael Jordan?
He basically did the European version of that by comparing himself to Luka Doncic.
All right. God. I love these kids. I love it.
Yeah, there's just no...
Who do you think your game is most like? Only the greatest players playing the game.
Who gets buckets on this team, CJ? Who's the biggest bucket getter on the team? Me. With a straight face. You know who we should talk about, Hummer? We should talk about a little bit more about CJ and what role he fills, how it might change the outlook or doesn't change the outlook in 2023-24 for the basketball team. And again, roster is not finalized. I don't want to go full bore in terms of, you know, making predictions and putting our stamp on exactly how we think this shakes out long term. But I do think that you kind of hit on it already. CJ is a floor spacer. He's a guy who can move off the ball, and he's a guy who has extensive experience playing college basketball on winning programs that played tournament basketball. So from a habit standpoint, from an understanding of basketball standpoint, basketball IQ.
Is he the only one on the roster who has tournament experience?
I would have to think he is. Yeah. Right now, I think he is. Landers Nolly would have had tournament experience. He's gone.
Odie did Wake Forest. I don't think they made it. They weren't too hot.
No tournament experience. Temple has not made a tournament. So Jameel Reynolds does not have tournament experience. None of the Bearcats. None of the Bearcats have tournament experience right now. So CJ is bringing that vital.
Newman maybe. Newman has Clemson made it.
That's a good call. You know what? Let's put our crack research team on that, and we'll circle back on it. But yeah, scale of 1 to 10. How excited are you for CJ Fredrick? How big of a get is this for Wes Miller?
It's a huge get. You needed a win from the transfer portal. you needed because of the of what we well, it's no secret. We've been going after high profile transfers. Basically everybody that was in the top, you know, if you were in the top 50 and you'd entered the portal, chances are you got called by Wes Miller. A couple of them showed serious interest for a period of time that we ultimately ended up losing, particularly Aaron Estrada to Alabama. It's good to get a win from a player who, right, there's a lot of upside here, right? It's not, I don't think there's a whole lot of downside, you bringing CJ Fredrick onto the roster. Either he plays the same as you know what he did, or he exceeds it, or he exceeds what he did in the past season, and that's a win. That is a win for this team. We don't have, or we haven't had in a while, what you would consider a knockdown shooter. If you get a guy who's going to hit three-pointers at 41, 46%, I don't care how often you take them. Take 100, right? Make me 46 of them. I don't care, right? And I think that's a huge upgrade, having a piece like that on the roster who has that potential. They have done it. You know, you're going to get – they have the whole offseason and potentially 2 years with this player. So I think it's a huge get. I think it's a great way to not have to fill another roster spot next year in the portal. So I think it's a great way that we're filling out the roster, that we're going to have some waterfall effect when it comes to bringing in recruits and filling more spots next year.
He's a stopgap player. I think it is a good get for Wes Miller. I think it's a type of player that is aided by the fact that he's from Cincinnati, Ohio. And the more I've surveyed some players, Hummer, I'm trying to get a grasp on what drives movement in the transfer portal, because I think you and I gravitate to the concept that money talks, and it talks the loudest. It's the loudest talking thing in the room. There's nothing that speaks more volumes than the depth of the green that you can offer someone. But I am open-minded to the fact that there are going to be other motivators. And I think one of the bigger motivators that can exist is the idea of a homecoming. It's the idea of playing in front of your family and having that support system around you. And in this case, I'm assuming that our NIL was strong enough and got the job done and was able to incentivize CJ to, in fact, fulfill his wishes to come to Cincinnati. But I also think that there's an innate desire there to play at home, and that's what allows us to fend off the likes of West Virginia and Oregon, two schools who have immensely deep pockets and are incredibly aggressive in the portal. And you see it with Al Huggins is going about things over at West Virginia. That's tough to fend off. But in this case, the combination of Wes Miller, his ability to develop the relationship, and that goes back now 2 years, but also the fact that we're in Cincinnati, Ohio, and we do have an NIL infrastructure in place that, like, we're not calling weak, we're not calling non-existent. We're saying it exists. It's not God level, but it's there, and it's able to get the job done in this case.
Look, what's the right way to say this? We're comparing ourselves. Me and you, or me in particular, whoever, I'm not going to speak for you. When we're comparing the NIL and we're talking about who are we losing to, you know, we're talking about a tier one. And I think the top tiers of NIL, that's where we aspire to be. We're going to the best conference in basketball in the country. We're trying to get some of the best recruits in the country. We're going to be squaring off against schools that have the highest tier. To the point where there's all kinds of rumors flying around about what guys are getting paid. Who knows what's actually true, what's actually false. But I heard somewhere in the neighborhood of Aaron Estrada getting offered, you know, seven figures plus a buyout for Hofstra. And it's another
what
thing.
What the hell is a buyout for Hofstra, by the way?
I've thought about this because I was reading Matt Ruiz, that his name down there in Miami. One of the players in Miami has a two-year.
John Ruiz.
He, one of their players, and I can't remember the name, doesn't matter. Two-year NIL deal. So if you have a two-year NIL deal and you go to transfer, if you want to transfer, I'm guessing there's probably a contractual obligation there, and that school who wants to purchase you, offer you an NIL deal to come to your school would in fact probably have to reimburse the NIL entity or buy out that contract that you have entered into with that entity to represent them with your name, image, and likeness. So I imagine there's actually going to be excess payments to fulfill contractual obligation these players are entering into. that go beyond just what is being given to the player up front. So I'm imagining maybe just, and I don't know, I said it's a rumor, but either the way, if that's the case, these NIL funds are going to be massive. You're talking Texas got seeded with $10 million right off the bat. Yeah. We celebrated a $50,000 match. Texas was funded with $10 million to start. Tennessee said some crazy number that they want to have $25 million or whatever. I know they haven't hit that goal. But you're seeing teams in Texas in particular is where I've been paying attention to this, because Texas has a law that they have to disclose NIL deals apparently. And with that, you're seeing rosters starting to hit the neighborhood of $4, $5 million a year as of right now for payroll on some of these schools. That's where I'm worried. That's where I'm saying maybe we're happy with where we're at, but maybe we're not where we really need to be to win some of these larger battles, which is why we have lost an Aaron Estrada. We lost an Isaiah Collier, right? It might be that USC is in California. It's a great location. That's fine. But at the end of the day, they were able to offer intangibles that go beyond, you know, the women.
Or tangibles.
I'm going to say more the creative agency. That was called the creative agency that's out there. They do have a rabid football fan base when they're winning. They play in the freaking Rose Bowl, right? They have a donor base. They're in LA.
I'd pump the brakes on calling them rabid. I've seen plenty of pictures of a stadium that's quite putrid.
Fine. Everybody can have that when you lose, but it doesn't matter. My point is USC doesn't have a historically good basketball program. It's not some powerhouse. It's nowhere near a blue blood. Go down the street to UCLA. That's a powerhouse basketball program, not USC. You don't go to USC and think, you know what? I am so excited to come here to play basketball. Maybe you are right now if that's where Bronny James is going to go. But I'm sure there's payments being given there. These players aren't stupid. They're out here to make money. They're out here to get to the NBA. They're out here to put themselves in the best situation you can. And I'm sure there are going to be other things like you mentioned with the CJ Fredericks, you know, example. I'm just thinking, look, we're going to have to do it. My hypothesis here, and this is purely speculation when it comes to eggs down the road, is that they hired a coach that we know back in the day was doing unethical things in terms of recruiting players and taking payments from, allegedly, I don't want to get sued here. Allegedly paying players, you know, through Adidas and using, you know, basically bagmen to drop off bags for players. Like there was a federal indictment that basically named the Arizona Wildcats in that scheme along with Arizona and along with Kansas. He was basically let go from whatever findings happens in that investigation. He gets hired at Xavier. The man knows how to use NIL because he was doing it before it was even a thing. So I wouldn't be surprised right now if you have some unnamed donor who's not started officially a collective, who's behind Sean Miller and Sean's saying to someone, tell him I want this guy. And boom, the conversation's off and running. And like, maybe it's more a little bit more of an unethical way of doing it.
This is all alleged.
All conjecture.
This is all conjecture, speculation.
All alleged. But I'm just saying, like, if that's where I'm reading the tea leaves, when you're seeing all of a sudden Sean Xavier pulling in, you know, big name people off the transfer wire, out of the portal immediately as soon as it's happened, they've been talking to these guys. It's what happens. So I do think that's what happens. And I think we also have to be prepared and keep building our NIL, and we need to keep it going and get it bigger so that we are a top tier. Cause at the end of the day, we're going to be competing against Big 12 schools, Kansas,
right?
Kansas State. Like
it's not a finished product. And I suspect some people are listening to this wondering why the hell why are we defensive? Why are we beating this drum that is the NIL conversation, which frankly includes a lot of unknowns, right? When we say lagging behind or not exactly where we want to be, that's founded in some research on our side. Okay. It's also just knowing what it looks like and some of the offers that are being speculated about across the country. But the big wild card in this whole conversation is the ethics component and the fact that there are schools out there that are making offers and making promises and telling guys that when you come here, you're going to get this type of money that we know it's not going to actually be delivered upon. You know, there's going to be broken promises. There's going to be athletes that get screwed out of deals that they thought they had locked in. And we're just at the tip of the iceberg of those things. And I think what I really, really like so far about the Cincy Reigns experience and how our friend Brian Fox is going about it is being done in a very ethical way. I don't get the sense that Cincinnati's out there making promises they can't keep. I don't think there's deals being made where Cincinnati can't deliver once the commitment happens. I do think that we have to pay attention and have these conversations around the financial aspects of college basketball and football recruiting now, because they are front and center.
Welcome to professional sports, baby. What are we talking about right now with the Bengals? Joe Burrow gets his fifth-year option exercise for $29 million. When are we going to give him the actual extension to make him the highest-paid quarterback over the next 8 years? That's college sports now.
Yeah,
that's the reality of the situation.
And I want to pause it. I want to pause us going any deeper on this conversation, because if you're in the Catskiller Social Club Discord, a job posting was put into this Discord, I think about a week ago. And this job posting is for Cincy Slangin, one of the three podcasts that are a part of this network, the other two being Go Bearcats, hosted by Brandon. And then we also have our friends at Viva La Cats, hosted by Justin and Steve. Cincy Slangin is looking for an ombudsman. Okay.
What is an
Do you know ombudsman. What an ombudsman is? What is
here's what I Google. I Google it, and the first thing that pops up is nyc.gov. Office of the Ombudsman, providing information and education on homeless services, providing a supportive client experience through effective and compassionate ...
Well, that's New York City's definition of an ombudsman. I want to go back to our job posting. The Cincy Slangin Ombudsman would be responsible for listening to the podcast, settling disputes. So if you and I have a topic that we just can't seem to flesh out, we're not really sure who's on the winning side, this person's going to come on occasionally and help us settle disputes. Offer, this is maybe the most important aspect of this job, offer critiques on segments, takes, opinions, and so forth. And then from those responsibilities, I want this person to ideally come on the podcast about once a month, maybe more, but maybe, you know, around once a month to work through some of these things. I think that essentially the ombudsman for Cincy Slangin is going to be an accountability partner of sorts.
Where did you come up with this?
There's a few different places. It was bouncing around in my head for a while, Hummer. I look at it like me and you live in our own Cincy Slangin bubble. It's a very small bubble. And I think both of us are good about having different opinions and voicing them and being willing to go back and forth and banter. But I also think there's times, and I think I'm learning it mostly through the CSC Discord, you know, there's people who don't always agree with the angle we're taking and maybe think that we have a blind spot or want to share a different perspective. This role allows that to exist. It allows us to be challenged on our ideas, on our opinions, on our narratives that we may be shaping on this podcast. And we'll see how it goes. It's very important that this person comes on and takes themselves as seriously as we do, which is not seriously at all. So our first audition is going to be tonight. We are going to have our first ombudsman tryout. We're going to call it the Cincy Slangin's Next Top Ombudsman. And this person will be Nick Bauer. And so he'll be on later in the podcast to go through some notes he had about, I think, specifically the last episode. And we'll work through those thoughts and hear Nick out and also potentially push back. We'll see where it goes. I don't know how it's going to go.
Loser of the first round gets Tucker Carlson.
Gets what?
Gets fired. Cincy Slangin, the Fox News of college sports.
Ombudsmen are meant to be very neutral. And so I think it's going to be interesting to see who can come on the podcast and sort of serve as that stabilizing voice, that very calm demeanor
It sucks that we have the same opinion on the one thing, too, I really want to talk about that's highly controversial.
What's that?
I want to spend a solid 10 minutes talking about Coach Prime.
Well, that's where I was going to go next, Hummer. And the only reason I want to go there, it's a Cincinnati Bearcat podcast, but I'll say this. when you spend as much time as we did back in December talking about Coach Prime and how well he would fit at Cincinnati and the fact that, you know, this is a no-brainer that we need to go after him as aggressively as possible, we should probably talk about Coach Prime when the school he did decide to go to, the Colorado Buffaloes, maybe a future Big 12 member, by the way, so it could be on topic, when they have an exodus that's basically unrivaled. I don't know if there's precedent for what's happening right now.
Yes, there is, on a much smaller scale, but on a per capita basis, on a ratio basis, John Brannan.
I think it's
over half the team. Poof, gone.
Well, I don't want to go into too much depth on it, but I do think it's worth a reaction. Are you looking at this as saying, wow, good, thank God we dodged that bullet. Wow, this is why I'm not an athletic director. Or are you looking at it like, hey, guys, come on, pump the brakes. It's freaking April.
I'm just going to quote the great Coach Prime. I'm bringing my luggage with me, and it's Louie. Go ahead and jump in the portal. He told us exactly what was going to happen. He telegraphed the entire move that, yes, I'm going to force people out. I'm going to clear space out on the roster. Would I be a little worried as a Bearcat fan right now? Yes, I would. I would probably be freaking out a little bit. I'm like, oh my God, you just let the guy who scored two touchdowns and caught what 100 and something yards on our spring game. Okay. All right. Freaking out. No, I have total faith that Coach Prime's going to turn this around. I truly believe that this man knows nothing but success. And I think that this is just, it's his way of wanting to do it. It's why he wanted total control of the program, because he wanted to get rid of half this roster to make space for incoming studs. He's literally going to have a closet full of Louis, MCM, Prada, Dior, Ferragamo. Look, we got a coach wearing Ferragamos. Coach Prime is going to put a whole closet full of Ferragamo shoes on the wall. So, no, I have total faith that actually he's going to be successful at Colorado, because I think he is embracing college sports for what it is now, which is, in fact, a business. He's not going to dilly around that fact that this is a business. Come play for me, and I will show you how to be prime time, baby.
I do think that any Bearcat fan that looks at what's happening at Colorado and says to themselves, see, you're such a fucking idiot for thinking that he would have worked here. Look what he would have done at Cincinnati. Let's also remember that Colorado went 1-11 last year. Let's also remember that Colorado hasn't sniffed the level of success the Cincinnati Bearcats football program has experienced over the last decade.
We have some Louis on our team. Is that what you're trying to say? We have some Louis.
I tend to think that, you know, the reason that that job could, in a sense, be appealing to him was that he could justify starting from a completely blank slate. And when you look at a wide receiver stats from a spring game, that is a spring game following up a 1-11 season, you know, he might not be that concerned over anybody that's departing the team. Is it chaotic? Seemingly, yes. Would I be nervous as a fan? You're goddamn right I would be. Am I writing off Deion Sanders because of a rash of portal departures on April 25th or by April 25th of 2023? Absolutely not. This is just the beginning of what I think is a total reshaping of how they do things at Colorado. I do think that they'll replenish. I do think that he's hired some very impressive coaches. I am not writing off the primetime experience. And I do think it was worthwhile to address it here on the Cincy Slangin podcast because of the fact that we did ride so hard for that Coach Prime potential.
Look, if Nate Oates can still recruit people after one of his former players was charged with murder, a current player was allegedly the one who may or may not have driven the murder weapon to the scene, and then on top of that has his latest player transfer accused of having a gun and marijuana. If he can keep people coming to play at Alabama for basketball, Coach Prime, the smoothest man on a football field, wearing a cowboy hat, Gucci sunglasses, and a gold chain with a custom Prime jacket. I think that man's going to recruit some talent. That's a good-looking football coach.
We're going to leave it there, but we'll keep checking in on the experience as time goes on. I don't know if you saw this. I did partake in what's becoming known as the pod poll. It's a podcaster poll for this coming football season.
I'm so glad you reminded me.
It's a top 25 poll that that this guy Dionysius Miller is running. If you want to follow
him, sure, I think he had 250 followers too. Somehow Coomer was like, you know, this is a great idea.
No, he's got less than 100. He's got 94 followers. If you can find him,
he needs to pump those numbers up. Those are rookie numbers. Come on, Slangers.
It's going to be pumped up during the football season because I think this poll is going to be very fun to track. But you can find him at Pod Poll. Cincy Slangin is officially one of the official voters of this podcast poll. And it's essentially a poll that has, you know, some fancy formula where he's aggregating a bunch of top 25 rankings from different podcasts around the country, representing different conferences, different schools. And I decided to partake. He asked us if we would partake. And I said, yes, we definitely should do that. And I think the one ranking that I'm regretting the most right now is that I did put Colorado in my top 25, and that's probably a bit premature. I think Deion Sanders is going to improve upon his results their results from last season. Is he going to get to the top 25? Probably not. That's probably not happening year one. But if you look at our full rankings, it's worthwhile because we were one of the top five most peculiar.
Not we're. This was all Coomer's doing. I'm going to give credit where credit's due on this one.
I'm proud of it, especially because the thing that made us the weirdest was the fact that I put OSU, Ohio State, at 15 and justified it through.
That was the weirdest thing you did?
He says it was. Yeah, he says it was the weirdest thing
I did. Not that you've ranked UK twice.
I corrected that for the record. Let the record show I corrected that. Well, look, we've got a guest, Hummer. We've got a guest waiting in the lobby. We're going to get him on here. I alluded to it earlier. We have our first
hateful eater. Come on, greatest comment I've ever read on Twitter. The at SSN American and at Cincy Slangin are the only credible football sources from this day forth.
What I think an Oklahoma State fan made that comment simply because of the fact that we put him in their top 25. So we'll be right on some things. I feel confident that we're going to be right on some things. I'm going to be wrong about some things too. But go ahead.
If you're right on the good stuff, I'm going to totally jump on the credit bandwagon there.
Yeah. Yeah. We're going to brag about it. So let's get to our guest here, Hummer. We've got our first official Ombudsman tryout on the line. He's been a longtime listener, someone who's actually been demanding to be on the podcast for quite some time. We had a friendly wager earlier this basketball season that if Kalu Azikbe, I think, had like a 10-6, 10-7, he would have appeared on the podcast. Sure enough, that didn't happen. So he's found
Close enough.
He's found his way on in another way, and that's to be a candidate for the Cincy Slangin Ombudsman position. So without further ado, Nick Bauer, welcome to the Cincy Slangin podcast.
Thanks for having me. Honored to be here as the first candidate.
I'm very excited about this experience. We'll see where it takes us. Hummer was laughing earlier because he didn't know what an ombudsman was. I'm not really sure I know what it is, but we're going to make it our own thing.
I don't think you should have told me before we had him on, because I'd be like, so wait, is this someone who challenges me for best hair on the pod? Because that's strong.
He does have very good hair. I am not in the running for this, unfortunately. Nick, before we get into, you know, your credentials, maybe that's what we should start with, is your a little bit about yourself. Maybe, you know, telling people your origin story for being a diehard Cincinnati Bearcat fan, what you do, whatever you want to share, Nick. Tell the people who you are and why you are submitting your candidacy for this ombudsman position.
Yeah, no problem. So, yeah, just quick background on me. I'm originally from Columbus, Ohio. You don't got to tell me. moved to Cincinnati for undergrad, graduated from UC in 2017. So this year actually marks
you're young,
10 years in Cincinnati this year. So that's pretty crazy. Work in advertising and spent a few years, you know, working in ad agencies and then was at Kroger. And in 2021, I returned to UC, where I still work and am lucky to serve as the associate director for marketing and brand for the institution. So before we go any further, I am obligated to say all views and hot takes expressed on this podcast are my own. They do not reflect my employer or President Neville Pinto in any way.
Wow. This feels like we've taken it up a level, and already I'm wondering, is Nick coming on here to, like, you know, brainwash us, reshape the narratives that we try and drive here? We'll find out.
Yeah. So I guess, should I jump in with my pitch on why I'm the right person for this job?
Take it over. This is like, it feels like a little bit too interviewy right now, but this is a great way to start an interview where you just take the bull by the horns and say, you know what? Don't ask me any questions. I'm going to tell you why I'm your guy.
That's all right. Yeah. I've got some notes written down so we can run through these. I'm glad you brought it up because I do have to admit, had no idea what this word meant. But after a very quick Google search, I do believe that I am the right candidate for this role. So
when you did the Google search, what was your number one result? I want to see how this differs from what mine was.
It was like appointed counsel person to settle disputes or something like that. It gave me enough background to know.
What do I Google?
I forgot something completely different.
Completely different. That's okay, literally the office of ombudsman. The Office of Ombudsman for New York City.gov.
That is not what I received.
No education. Yeah, homeless. I mean, I'm really disappointed.
Let Nick tell the story. Let Nick tell us why he's the right guy for this job.
Well, for starters, I've already made it official in my Twitter bio. So that was official as of 2 days ago when I was supposed to appear on the pod. So if you don't select me, you know, I'm going to look like a liar. So that's not cool.
Look like a jabroni.
Yeah. But, all right. So prior to UC, I did actually spend one season as an NCAA quarterback. Play is a stretch. I was like seven string Division III quarterback. But that is probably a pretty rare title in the social club. So, while I never actually played, you know, I do feel like I do bring, you know, a field general's point of view to what's happening on the field and on the court. I'm not just firing off wild takes. So I feel like
Who would fire off wild takes?
Especially this week, it's been out of control. So, and it wasn't me, any of them. So, and then I think my other main selling point is I've lived both sides of the UC fandom coin, I feel like. So, as a student, you know, I was insanely passionate. I was one of the leaders of Rally Cats, you know, lived and died with every win and loss. To my knowledge, I am the only person who has ever received a written warning from Fifth Third Arena security 2 hours before tip-off. That was at the 2016 Crosstown Shootout. So,
go on. What was happening? Were you heckling the favorite player?
It was the most, I mean, I don't think I deserved it, but I wear it with pride that I received it. I wish I still had the card because it was like the funniest thing I've ever seen. Like the fact that they have these pre-printed cards out, I've never seen anyone else get one. And I don't even remember what it said, but it was ridiculous.
You had to do something pretty bad because I remember at the Temple game before COVID, I went with Coomer and I got yelled at by the usher lady twice. Telling me to calm down because I was screaming and yelling obscenities at the refs, and I didn't even get a card.
I mean, no one else was even in the arena at this point. Like, I think they said they were handing them out, just like trying to get ahead of it before things got too out of control. So
It was like Minority Report. They were tracking down for pre-murder, pre-heckling.
It was uncalled for. I think probably the only time I didn't deserve a card. So you could have given them to me at any other point or immediately before the game, probably would have deserved it, but nevertheless.
Was it colorful? Was it like a red card or like a yellow card?
Unfortunately, I don't think so, but it had like, the language on it was so absurd. And the fact that these are like official, it was like an official card.
They should bring that back. Like, honestly, like if I were a member of the fan council, I'm recommending we bring back warning cards.
It was, because I think it said like, this is your one and only warning, like for the season. Like if something else happens, like you're done. So luckily somehow didn't come to that.
Hand out the warning cards though. There's no follow-up red card. You only hand out warning cards, and it's basically an incentive to create the rowdiest possible crowd. We want to incentivize people to get warning cards because they want to collect them. They want to put them in their wallet. They want to put them on the wall, but we never actually eject you because we want you to be out of as control as possible.
This is the limited edition.
At the end of the season, whoever has the most warning cards, free season tickets the next year.
Or like, some sort of honorary fan number into the rafters, essentially. You were the rowdiest and craziest fan this season. 2023 belongs to you.
I could get behind that. Let's hang a banner. I used to be pretty crazy and emotional about everything. But now, on the flip side, especially as an employee, I think I'm much more level-headed. And while I feel like probably always have an optimistic viewpoint, can see both sides of the argument. So I have some notes from your guys' debate from the past podcast, which we can dive into if we want, but
we will. I just want to make sure that I'm pointing out the most level-headed take you've had other than the clue is Zikbe take. I'm going back to March 7th here because I had to go see, I'm Twitter stalking here. Had to go and see the Twitter profile here. I'm only going to go back this far, though. DDJ is going on a stretch that rivals 2011 Kemba Walker.
Sadly, didn't happen, but.
He said he's an optimist.
That's a wild take. That's a wild take. I love it.
First off, all right, let me clarify. The Kalua Zikbe take, I was highly intoxicated.
Been there.
You caught me off guard. So, like, that doesn't even hold up. Plus, it basically did happen. So.
It just happened in the NIT. Almost.
Well.
Not quite.
Like Tulane at the two. Didn't he? There was something. There was a game that I wasn't watching. And because I was like busy. And then I checked my phone and everyone was like tagging me on Twitter or like in the Discord. And they were like, it's happening. I feel like he got to like 9-5 or. I mean, cut the kid a break. Like he had to face some adversity. So
close only counts in horseshoes and hand grenades here. Okay.
And Kalua Zikbe.
He flirted with double digits once or twice, maybe grabbed a few rebounds occasionally. March 7th was after the SMU senior day. So basically you were calling your shot for David DeJulius to take the Bearcats on an incredible run in the conference tournament or beyond. And that didn't quite happen, but again, got a taste of some NIT success, took it to Utah Valley and nearly made the semifinals. So not all was lost, but he did go 1 of 10 against Houston. That was tough. That was a tough break. But look, I think we're getting off topic here a little bit.
Qualified. All right. We sound like we have a qualified candidate. We need to get into the meat of it.
Baseline qualifications seem to be met. Nick, you do listen to the Cincy Slangin' podcast, right? We are
someone who
does listen. We haven't driven you off yet. So I think baseline qualifications met. And I think a great way to move forward in terms of finding the right guy and whether you're the right guy for this role is to let you ombuds. So go ahead. I'll let you ombuds for a few minutes here. Let us know what you want to dive into. It's disputes between Hummer and I, whether it's disagreements and narratives that we might be framing or shaping on the podcast, take it away.
Yeah. So, I mean, I just re-listened to the most recent episode and was trying to write down takes that I agree with and takes that I disagree with. So let's see where to start. I mean, I guess first I'll say I loved the anti drinking and driving, but pro drinking and driving recreational vehicle state. So I was really on board with that. That jumped out first. All right. So I'll start with, I disagree with Hummer.
This podcast is not for kids.
I disagree with Hummer that we have low expectations for this football season. I think I said this in the Discord after the spring game that I was not in attendance for, that I think we'll be competing for a conference title. So I think that's the expectation, whether we get there or not remains to be seen. But I think that was a tall task, regardless of if there was a coaching change and movement in the transfer portal and whatnot. So I still think the expectation is there. And I think to lower the bar otherwise, I think that's wrong.
Do you think that's unfair though to Scott Satterfield? Like, do you think,
I'm not saying fire the guy if we don't. I'm saying I believe that there is a chance he could get us there this year.
I think there's a better question to ask here than is that unfair to Scott Satterfield? Because it's not unfair to have expectations for a new coach if you're saying our program is going to be top 25, top 10, whatever type of program we are. It's not unfair to put expectations on a coach like that. We put expectations on Wes Miller the same way. We want tournament. We want to make the tournament. Our expectations are to make the tournament, right? And next year is kind of that put up or shut up year, right? What makes you think, like, not just from an optimistic standpoint, but what really makes you just think that, all right, we have the pieces in place. We have the stuff that's going to make us compete with, because next year I hate putting them on a pedestal, but we still have OU in the conference. We still have Texas. We still have TCU. We still have some really good football teams in this conference that after we did lose our head coach, we've also had a wave of transfers coming in, and a completely different team that Cincinnati is going and competing day one for a championship in the Big 12 in football.
Not a completely different team. Completely different offense, maybe, but I think the core of why we will be able to compete is this defense should still be unbelievable. I mean, we should be able to own the line of scrimmage in every game. If our defensive line is as good as we have said they were, you know, I know we were still in the American Conference last year, but you know, the argument was always like, okay, well, this defense is, you know, top 10, top 15 nationally. A lot of that core is still there. And I think we're going to be playing a more aggressive style of defense. So I think while we might give up, you know, some more explosive plays on like the back end, I still think that with the talent the defense has, we should be in every game. Not win every game, but we should be in every game, at least like into the fourth quarter. And so I think we have a better chance than a lot of people are giving us based off that alone. And then on the optimistic side, for the first time in 6 years, we have a head coach who is an offensive X's and O scheme guy. So if we can keep games close into the fourth quarter, I'm optimistic that this offense and Scott Satterfield will figure out a way, I think, to surprise some people, to surprise some teams.
I like the take. I like the take of, to put it very clearly and succinctly, have expectations with perspective. Fair? Is that essentially what you're saying? Have expectations.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I mean, I would say anything less than a bowl game is a major disappointment. I heard on that other podcast network that we'd be lucky. We're looking at, you know, it's a reach to get to six games. I think that's, yeah. I think six games is the base.
Are we talking to 10, 12? We talking to Tulane podcast, who the role, you know, you guys are, No, I'm just kidding.
I actually think, to me, that's where these conversations get interesting, Nick. And I actually appreciate your perspective and tend to skew toward your side, which is how I've treated Wes Miller, frankly, for the last 2 years, where I want to see results. I want to see improvement. I want to see a product on the field or in the court in that case that is something that you can sort of envision building into something greater as they continue to get their hands on different types of recruits and just more time with the program to shape it and make it what they want it to be. I think that when you are so adamant that it's unreasonable to expect even a bowl game, you're sort of shaping and framing the narrative in a certain way to take all pressure off. And there's value in that because you don't want a rabid fan base after a coach after 1 year, given that it is year one as they transition from American Athletic to Big 12. But at the same time, this is not a broken program that needs to be rehabilitated from the depths of hell. This is a program that's been competing for, you know, obviously 2 and 3 years ago, competing for playoff appearances, making a playoff, and then competing for an American Athletic title. This should not be a situation where we're tearing it down to the studs and rebuilding.
Exactly. And we also,
another
point to why I'm optimistic about Scott Satterfield is, you know, this isn't his first time taking a program up a level. So I know we can all, you know, kind of brush off the fact that he had success at Appalachian State because, you know, whatever, they were a G5 team, or they weren't even Division I at the, you know, when he was there, and he took them up into Division I. But yeah, I mean, like, he's been here before on a different level and seen a lot of success. So I think that's, you know, just another reason to, will it happen that quick? Will it happen this year at all? Who knows? I'm not saying like,
I took it as a guarantee, and I think we should move on to your next topic. But Nick guaranteed
Big 12 title next season. Okay. I'm with you that bowl game, yes, 100%. That should be an expectation. We shouldn't be going. It's not going to go backwards to the point where we win two games. That's an embarrassment, and that should not happen, especially with the aspirations that we have for this program. I still disagree with you that we're going to be competing for a Big 12 title. I don't think this is where Coomer and I flip, I think, with the way he's handled Wes Miller. I've been kind of more okay with Wes Miller. Let's keep going. I'm fine with what we're seeing. I'm seeing progress, where he's been more of the optimist on Coach Satterfield, where I've been the opposite, saying, show me. I don't want to say it, because last time I did this, I projected a guy to Hall of Fame, and he was fired after 2 years. So maybe I'm just being cautious, taking a step back and saying, you know what, show me that you can do better here than what you did at Louisville.
Hummer is not ready to get hurt again.
So I think maybe that's where I'm coming from with my apprehension with Satterfield, is show me that you can do better than what you did at Louisville before I'm going to give you my praise and adulation.
I'm glad you brought that up, because that's my next take right here. So, yeah, I mean, you said you won't give him the benefit of the doubt and he has to prove it to you first. I think as fans, you know, I feel like it's our job, you know, it's not. I mean, I think that. But I guess I'll say it. I think it is our job to be supportive until they. And the other way around, until they prove that they're not worthy of that support. I think people say, you know, one of the reasons for the lack of success at Louisville was all the stuff going on in the, you know, their athletic department's a mess, and all the fans wanted them out the whole time, and there was no support. So I think if we want to have, you know, we obviously all want him to have the most success possible. I think giving that support and that hype up front, because quite frankly, as you discussed, the only thing he's been able to do up until this point is recruit. And I think what we've seen the past 2 weeks is definitely hype worthy and support worthy, that this guy knows what he's doing. He's built his staff in a way that is going to lead to recruiting success. And Coomer, I think it was you that said you had some Satterfield slander. You said, not a guy who will create national buzz for our program. I disagree. I think he's a silent killer. All right. I think
That is an oxymoron. That is the definition of an oxymoron. Like, won't create national bud, silent killer.
Okay, so Scott Satterfield himself is a silent killer. I think it's going to be more about the team and the program. The national buzz is going to come when we're in the college football playoff again, when we're winning the Big 12 championship.
If he's bringing in
hype-worthy players, right. I think it's more about the team to him than his predecessor. I think it became a lot more about the coach who's on national TV appearances talking about himself pretty much.
Well, we loved it. We ate it all up. Admit it. You loved it. I loved it.
We hate it now.
Real quick, let me make a comparison. If you want to compare it, I think the way to make people understand what Nick is saying is that if you look at farts, when you have an audible fart, one that's really loud, wet, very, very noisy, that's something that does resonate nationally quickly. There's buzz.
What you're saying,
Scott Satterfield is an SPD. He's silent but deadly. Like, if the smell is worse, it's more potent.
Let me see if I understand what Nick is saying.
Satterfield doesn't
seem to be about himself. He is more about the team than coming off of being, let me promote Scott Satterfield. I'm going to let my staff be the ones who get the glory. It's going to be my staff who's releasing all the memes on Twitter about the recruits coming and doing it in their own cryptic way that no one can really seem to understand what's really going on, but we're eating it up. Where Luke Fickell was the guy of, let me be on TV. Let me get my name out there. Let me have my name be, you know, I'm upset that I didn't get Notre Dame, that I want to take the first ride out of here. Where on the other hand, Satterfield is saying, well, you know what? I just got the top, was it top 10? Is that right? No. Correct me if I'm wrong. It's like top 10 largest pool for assistant coaches.
That's a good question. I don't know the number there.
I know it's high. I know it's large. I know it's very comparable to the top programs in the country. I don't know the exact number, but if I'm seeing a lot, and I've said this too, this is probably maybe one of my issues with Satterfield, is that I don't hear him enough. But you're saying that's a good thing.
You're just not listening. I just think you're not listening.
That could be.
Well, I just think, I mean, he does things in a different way. Like, I can see him. I mean, I see why people are maybe turned off by his, you know, Southern slow draw way of going about things. But honestly, he reminds me of a young Nick Saban. I think there's some fire in there. I know. I didn't want to say it.
Careful.
I had a question mark here.
Careful.
That is how you get him on national TV.
I think in due time. I think right now he's focused. He's doing the work that he needs to be doing. He doesn't need to be on TV. Doesn't need, you know, I think we're going to be just fine.
Okay. I like it. That's a good note. It seems like that's a point on my side.
No, I gave you negative half a point there, but don't worry. I'm negative a full point.
Continue, Nick.
And then I think this might be like the main thing. I mean, we already, I feel like, discussed this at length in the Discord, but
well, that's why we're having you on. We're having you on to bring it to audio form.
The debate on how, you know, Wes and UC are performing in the transfer portal, and the assumptions or hinting at, you know, questioning, are we underachieving or aiming too low? So, Coomer, you said, and I quote, at some point, aren't we to expect more in the portal? And I would say, yes. At some point, I don't think that point is right now. I don't think we're to that point yet. You know, like Hummer, you compared us to the people across town and what they're doing. They were just ranked top 10 nationally this year. They've been in the tournament year after year.
No, they haven't.
They were in the tournament this year.
They made it this year.
That was the first year. They didn't make it at all under Travis Steele. Not mistaken.
Well, how long was Steele there? Two years.
Longer than JB.
Oh, all right. Well,
you know what though?
Sweet 16 recently.
That's a credit to you for not knowing, you know, anything.
Yeah, about we know way too much about
shit.
No, I'm the same way. Yeah, like how many years was he there? I don't know, but it wasn't great when he was there.
But all right, you compare. Okay, keep going. But I'll say, all right. So you compared us to Sean Miller, and what he is doing in the transfer portal. Again, I think it's just like, I mean, you have to realize like, he came from Arizona where he had success. Like Wes is still, I love Wes. I think he's the right guy. I think he still is. He has to prove it to players first. I think he has to prove that Cincinnati can be a winner and that they can be a winner in the Big 12. And I think we're just 1 year out. I think this time next year in the transfer portal, like we've already discussed, I think this is a huge year. And I think recruiting players to what the roster makeup is going to be going into next offseason, I think we will land the best of the best, you know, one of those top 10 guys in the portal, depending on what our needs are. And I do think it is unfair to, at this given point, say like he's underachieving in the transfer portal.
This is something Coomer and I've talked about offline. And why we haven't really responded to it in the Discord is because it's hard to get the thumbs working hard enough when you can speak it. I'm not saying Wes Miller is underachieving. That's not what I'm saying. I think Wes Miller is doing a really good job of getting out there and getting us in the conversation for these players. And he's taking his swings, which I love. I think where we're underachieving is on the NIL portion. And I'm not saying the NIL isn't doing a good job either. What I'm saying is they're not top tier. They're not going like Alabama. It might be Alabama basketball, but it's Alabama football that drives their NIL donations. And Alabama football is the most popular football team in college sports, followed by OSU, or Georgia. Whatever, most successful, but they're one of the most popular. You see, they're one of those teams that people will just wear their stuff because they're good. Same with like Notre Dame. Notre Dame might be doing it a little different though, because they, you know, they're Notre Dame and they're weird. But my point is they still are dealing with a lot of money that they can go and make outrageous offers. And we don't know what they are. That is what it is. I think Wes Miller is doing a good job given the cards that he has dealt. And I'm happy with what Wes Miller is doing. I'm not in any way, shape, or form wanting to sit here and say Wes Miller is terrible right now in the transfer portal. I think he's doing the best he can do with the cards that he's dealt. I think it's up to the donors. I think it's up to the university to maybe say, do you see Day of Giving? Like, look, we got $50 million coming into the university now annually, $40, $50 million. Why don't we divert more of those funds to the NIL? Because my wife pointed this out. We were talking with Coomer, and she got the Day of Giving email followed by a donate to the NIL email falling right after, $350 to NIL, saying they want 7,000 people to donate $350. That's $2.45 million, I think was the math, to raise for NIL. $350 is more than the average donation to UCATS. So we're not only are we asking people to donate more to NIL, but we're also asking them to donate more than what they donate to the university already. So the way I'm seeing it is I think that the NIL is getting there. It's okay right now. It's good. It's good enough, but it needs to get better. If we want to be that top tier that people are mentioning, we're just going to have to get better, and it's going to be growing. It's going to be time. Football certainly helped drive it there. We won in football. It got a big name. Now we keep that success rolling. We keep basketball rolling. Donations roll in. We compete even harder because at the end of the day, we are going to be competing against Alabama, Kentucky, USC, UCLA, Ohio
State.
What
about the Big 12 schools? Kansas.
Kansas. I know, but I'm talking about from a recruiting standpoint, a national recruiting standpoint. Basketball has been a highly national recruiting. It's not really a localized recruiting. We've always recruited well out of New York, for instance, right? Huggins recruited well out of Southern California, right? It's a national game when it comes to recruiting basketball, and that's where we play. And we have the ability to be next level. We are a great university. We are one that, in my opinion, when you look at what UC basketball offers in terms of we're an urban freaking campus, all right? We appeal to people in the Northeast because we bring that vibe that they want. right? You get a lot of people into a small space that's beautiful, clean, friendly, not full of assholes. We got pretty women, way prettier than the ones across town, right? If we're talking about the women.
2023.
Hot women.
It's 2023, Hummer. Jesus.
I don't really care. Someone else brought this up. Right, they brought up the women of Southern California. I'm bringing up the women of Cincinnati.
Don't blame your terrible take on someone else bringing it up.
I'm saying we have beautiful women in Cincinnati too. All right, I'm not afraid to admit that. We got great restaurants. We got great food. We got a good bar scene. We got good fun. Right, we got concert venues. We got pro football. We got pro baseball. Tell us what you don't have in Cincinnati that you have anywhere else in the country. And I say, this is a great place to come play basketball. This is a great place to recruit to. And we have the ability. I said this to Coomer in the past. We have the ability to be a blue blood. We're only missing a couple things, which is one, a recent national championship.
So you said a lot there. And I think it actually didn't necessarily address Nick's first point, which was a quote. Which is always makes me nervous when you quote me, but I was fine with it. You said,
well, that was your quote. You didn't quote me yet.
something along the lines of I you know, we're not performing up to par necessarily in the portal yet. So the reason I make a comment like that, Nick, is I just spent the last 12 months following this Bearcat basketball team. And when you looked at some of the transfer portal results we experienced last season, we landed Landers Nolly, which was a huge get. That's a, maybe not a top 10 portal guy, but I think maybe the perception would have been top 25. I can't remember the rankings, but he was a really well-regarded player that was good enough to where a friend of mine who's kind of a diehard hoops fan at large texted me and said, wow, you guys got Landers Nolly. That's a really nice player. So we were solid enough to land the likes of Landers Nolly from Memphis. Then we also added Rob Finnessy from Indiana, who had red flags both from an on-court performance standpoint, but also an injury standpoint. And we also added Kalua Zikpe, who based on pure appearance, I was excited about. He has the look of a Bearcat big. And when you looked at the old Dominion numbers, it looked like that was someone who with a 10 and 6, whatever he averaged, it looked like he could bring some sort of role playing front court presence to the team. And it didn't work out for whatever reason, but that led to criticism of some of the portal additions. And a lot of what I heard, and it's more from the news-making side of things with Bearcat Journal, was along the lines of, hey, once we're in the Big 12, those problems are solved. You can't really get top guys to want to come to the and play in the American Athletic Conference with only 1 year remaining. So we're in the Big 12 now. What we're doing now in the portal is, in fact, recruiting to a Big 12 team. It's also recruiting to a team that is not hamstrung in any way, shape, or form from an apparel deal, right? Everyone has also said that that is very significant in terms of recruiting players. And then I'm also hearing NIL is going great. And so in my mind, there should be expectations in terms of what we're accomplishing in the, on the portal side of things. Yes. Does Wes Miller have to prove he can have success in the Big 12? I do think he has to do that. I also think that many of the best players in the portal aren't looking at things and saying, they're not looking at it and saying, well, make it perfect before I come. They're going to say, I'm the missing piece you need. I'm the guy that when I show up and when I bring my skill set to your team, I'm going to help turn things around. And we're painting that picture and we're painting that narrative. I think Wes Miller is doing a really solid job on the relationship piece. I think that you cannot dispute that he has a very strong knack for connecting with players. He gets the current generation. He understands how to relate to and empathize with and bring out the best in personalities and connect with them at a level that says, I want to play for that guy. You've heard Landers Nolly talk about it. You've heard Jeremiah Davenport talk about it. You heard Mason Madsen talk about it before he left. He is doing a very good job of that. And that's why I tend to default to our NIL infrastructure being the likely source that's holding us back from competing for the very top talent in the portal or on the recruiting trail. I think that is something that does need to continue to be enhanced and improved upon in order to get Wes the recruiting success that we think he's capable of, right? I'm actually, in my opinion, I was blaming less of our portal success on Wes and more of it on, we need more time to ramp this thing up and get financially competitive with the top programs in the country. And I don't think that's a huge damning indictment on where NIL is at. It's saying that there's work to be done. And I think that's a fair critique.
So yeah, there was a lot said in that, in that segment. I agree that if your take is that we need more time to ramp up NIL, I think that's 100%, but that's not really how you framed it the first time. Because I think saying we need more time is saying it's not to the level where it should be at this given moment, which I think, one, none of us really know what it's at. So that's the other thing is, you know, we're
right.
And I also don't want to get into a gray area because I do work for the school, but I have nothing to do with athletics. So I'm not going to touch.
We know like the program Hummer's, that we developed is in good hands. We do know that. We do know the people that are running it are stand up people.
I think a lot of people, like fans and stuff, make assumptions on what players care about. Like, I'm not sure how much people really care about what brand of uniforms they're going to wear for 1 year. And if we're telling recruits, you know, hey, we're moving to this apparel provider next year, come wear it. And at the same time, though, I think you have to take a step back and look at, okay, for the trying to land Estrada, it was us and Alabama. Alabama can say the same things. Come here, wear Nike. Like, it's really not, I guess, we'll cover you know, up all like, your I don't crimes. Know. It's not, and it's just like, come here, come to a program that's winning at a pretty high level. And yeah.
Alabama, so I think you're making an exceptional point. So I have done some research on the side, surveying players who not necessarily were in the portal, but are playing college basketball, maybe playing college basketball at Cincinnati, trying to gain an understanding of, hey, what's driving portal decisions based on conversations you're having, based on guys you know that have entered the portal? Is it money? Is it coaching? Is it relationship? Is it apparel? Is it winning? What is driving decisions? And the responses I've gotten have indicated something that I think is not necessarily surprising, but is worth mentioning. It's based on the individual. You do have some people that are driven exclusively by money. It's Aaron. I would say Aaron Estrada likely falls into that bucket, right? This is a guy he was highly touted, went to Oregon, didn't work out right away, has entered the portal a couple of times since then, transferred to, I think, St. Peter's and then Hofstra, and has worked his way back up to reputationally being someone who is regarded as a top five transfer in the marketplace right now. Is he a high-level NBA prospect? No. Otherwise, he would be entering the NBA draft. But he is someone whose skill set is incredibly valuable at the college basketball level right now. So what better time than now to leverage that into getting the most possible capital for my services? And for that type of mercenary and that type of player, I don't think UC's in the game for that kind of guy right now. And I think that's bearing out with Alabama. Alabama could pay a lot more money for that type of guy. But knowing that every player is a little bit different, I think CJ Fredrick's an example of a guy who is probably demanding a pretty strong NIL fund, right? Or fee, for lack of a better term, right? Like, this is a guy that West Virginia probably comes to and says, blank check, we'll pay you whatever you want to come here. Because West Virginia is very aggressive.
Can we call him a high earner instead?
High earner.
Fee is so dirty.
Okay, he's a high earner.
He's going to earn them. Like, they earn this money, right? They Correct. Earn it. They are using their name, image, and likeness to promote them, the university.
We'll work on it.
In the team.
We'll get better at talking about it. But I think that's a guy who we can still make a strong offer to him, but we also have other things that are appealing, right? We have the coaching relationship that's appealing, and you heard him speak to that on Brendel's interview on BCJ, where he's saying that I connected with Wes really well 2 years ago, visited him, spoke to him for a few hours. It was a no-brainer. I'm coming to Cincinnati. He also is from Cincinnati. And so we had that to offer as well, where we have the home connection. So I think CJ Fredericks is an example where it was more than money, and that helped UC. And I think any player that we can find in the portal where maybe it's more than just the top dollar, if they care about the relationship piece, if they care about where you're playing and playing in the best conference of college basketball, we're going to be in a good spot to land those guys. I feel like there's those guys exist. They're out there. And Jameel Reynolds, TBD, solid role big. He was sought after by a few other strong schools. CJ Fredrick, sought after a lot of strong schools. Hopefully he stays healthy. His game spoke for itself at Iowa. Really high level player. And how we fill out this last spot is is to be determined. But I guess all that's to say is for people like Estrada, for the top guys who are going to leverage it for the top dollar, that's where I think we're not there.
I think that's probably a safe assumption. Yeah, I agree with that. I think for the way I took when listening, the way I took it was you guys saying like, we're not to the level of Alabama or Ohio State or, you know, some of these schools, and we should be like, we're doing something right. I think we're not there yet, but I think we're moving in the right direction. And I know it's frustrating.
Don't get me wrong. I do think we should be. It's just, we're not there yet.
Well, I would say we shouldn't be. I would argue that, but
that's why you're here for the argument, baby.
I think that's ridiculous. But I do, before we get too far, I want to jump back to some of the things you were saying, Hummer, about like, this is, you know, a great place to come play college basketball. We have all of these things. We're in this urban environment. We have these pro sports teams. We have, you know, all of this other stuff. And why I think, yeah, like we love it. We're UC grads. I do think a lot of schools probably recruit against that a little bit. I think that is, could be a negative point. Like, you know, if you're going to go to UC, you know, you're never going to be the biggest name in the city because there's Joe Burrow and there's all these other pro sports teams and they have a great football program. You come play for the Kansas Jayhawks in Lawrence, Kansas. Nobody gives a shit about anything else besides our men's basketball team. So I do think that it, same thing, I think, with UK. Like, there's nothing in Lexington, Kentucky. You and horse race guy wearing Jeff Ruby's outfit. Like, I think
a lot of the biggest programs are like that, honestly. I think we talked about this a few years ago with college sports.
We've mentioned that with football in particular, that if you go look at the biggest names in college football and draw a circle around the nearest professional football team, and there isn't one for quite a few hundred miles. The biggest college football teams.
But I don't think that's an excuse. I'm not saying, I don't think
it's different strokes for different strokes.
It's taken like, all right, let's look at the other side of it too.
I think that's why we've been successful with New York. Mick recruited New York heavily. Sean Kilpatrick is probably one of the biggest names we know from Brooklyn. And When I remember it, this might have been a Sean Kilpatrick quote, was literally legitimately saying the reason why he loved Cincinnati was it reminded me of Brooklyn. It reminded me of New York. It's urban, but it's not as crazy as New York.
And I think that's why we have success. If we can get players to campus too, you know, totally. I mean, not really apples to apples comparison, but like on the, just in terms of attendance for the university, like that's the biggest thing. If we can get students that are not from Cincinnati to campus, like the odds of them coming to school here are like astronomical compared to someone who is kind of going through their entire process without visiting the physical campus. So I think people are always super caught off guard and surprised by what Cincinnati offers. And I think, again, I think we're close. I'm not trying to make excuses. I think this is a big year for the basketball program. I think it's a big year for Wes to take a step forward in his not only player development, but also just coaching development, situational development, in-game adjustments. And I think we're having a totally different conversation this time next year.
I would say the conversation next year is actually going to be really similar to this year. And I say that for two reasons. One, we are going to a better conference. Our win total will decrease. I think we'll still have lots of wins. I think there is a chance maybe we're borderline bubble if we overperform. But I think if we perform where expectations are, I think we're probably NIT-ish. But I also think, because we know that the contract set up for Wes Miller is designed to give him time, that this is a buffer year. I think this is a year that's built into the contract at the buffer. So if it's not as successful as you would be, it's next year is when we're looking that that's when next this year, if we make the tournament, overachieve. The following year, we're expecting to make the tournament. We're going to make the tournament.
That's the best point Hummer made on the last episode, in my opinion, thinking back on it, was how this sets up, not for next year, but the year after, in terms of the development curve of Vic Lockin being a senior, being a guy who we all know I'm projecting to be quite good. The development curve of Reynolds being in the Monster Factory for a season and being someone who can score in the low post, but also the development of Skillings, Jizzle, Ravon, Reed. You have this young core of Bearcats, and that includes a Day-Day Thomas as well. This young core of Bearcats that will have a year under their belts in Big 12 basketball. They will have another year under Wes Miller. Wes Miller will have another year of improving that coaching acumen and maybe implementing a style of play that's more consistent game to game. And then it does set itself up for another year of NIL fundraising, another year of buzz in the Big 12, another year of all the other hype that comes with being in the Big 12 and apparel and whatever the case may be. I think that point by Hummer that 2024-25 is the year it's setting up for, where there's a ton of pressure on Wes Miller for great results, for making the tournament and having the kind of hype where it's like, we're going to win some games in the tournament. That's what I think it's setting up for. I think this year is setting up more for a stopgap year, a year where we look for the development of younger players. We look for the silver linings in what Jizzle and Ravon could bring in the future. But in terms of on-court results, I mean, look at how we played last season, where you get 23 victories, no real victories of significance, and we're going to play only those types of games in conference season next year. And I know some people are making the case the Big 12 will regress somewhat, but it's going to be a different beast next year entirely.
They're talking about adding non-conference games in November, just so we play everybody in the conference.
Would that count? Again, when I read that,
I don't think it would count. Discord,
I was thinking it was like a preseason thing, right?
It doesn't matter. We're still going to play them. Like, those are, we're going to be.
Oh, like they wouldn't even count on the record?
I don't think they would. I don't know if, or at least I don't know if they would count towards our conference record. I don't know. I don't know how they're going to do it. All I'm saying is they're going to add extra games that are quote unquote Big 12 caliber conference games. And that's daunting. Like that's a daunting task when you say you want to add four more of the toughest basketball in college to your schedule. So I don't know. This is I'm a big West fan, and I'm just saying next year, if we make the tournament, I think I think we're overachieving. I think the following year is the year where it's like, yeah, this is the time. We got a lot. All the pieces will be in place.
Nick,
we're not going to be relying on the portal next year. Portal will be adding a piece that you need, but if you don't get it, it won't matter because we will have the pieces on the roster already. And Wes is such a great relationship guy that I'm not really worried about people poaching our young talent.
I agree 100%.
Nick, your first run in Ombudsman here was very strong. I think you set a high bar for anybody who's coming for the job. You've assumed the sale in your profile. Nick was not kidding, Hummer. If you go to his Twitter profile, which
we already talked about share. This. I went and scrolled through his Twitter. I stalked him.
@NR Bauer, Bauer. If you want to follow Nick and all of his fun Bearcat content online. Any final thoughts before we wrap it up here? I know we did this longer than maybe I was expecting, but first time, I think it was great. You were making us clarify. You're challenging us on some points.
Fantastic. Yeah, this was a lot of fun. This was my podcast debut, so apologies for the audio listeners if I'm too loud or started to talk over somebody. Yeah, definitely, if you're listening, follow me on Twitter, although my Twitter is a lot more calm these days. I don't fire off the takes. I think I deleted something like 23,000 tweets before I took my job at
the That's university. What the podcast is for. You can say it on here, and it basically goes away after 24 hours.
Nobody listens to this.
I do. I just want to end with, I loved your segment with Justin Williams trying to guess his burner in the Discord. And so I will leave you with this fact that I'm at NR Bauer on the Discord, but I do have a second identity in the Discord, which I will not reveal, but I do have a burner.
Are you active with the burner? Are you an active participant?
I'm not going to confirm or deny, and I won't give any further hints. Maybe for the return episode this time next year, I can reveal who I am. But
it's just a mind-blowing bomb you dropped in here. Do you have any predictions on who Justin Williams is? Like, do you have a theory? Any sleeping gun?
No idea.
Do you think he actually had one in there?
He seems like a straight shooter, and he was leading.
He never
on
said he did
though.
He never
yeah.
said he did.
It seemed like.
Well, he said if you guess it, I'll tell you.
Yeah, and then he said, and "If I have one," and it felt like you've got one in there.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know.
Interesting. I'll put some thought into it. I conflicted feelings. I'm like, did we just set a crazy precedent where this guy's now got a burner in the Discord and can just be like a chaos agent? Are you burner? The guy who's come in and already been accused of being a Lisa Brannon burner. I don't know. Who knows?
The Lisa Brannon burner in the Discord.
You can if you guys guess it off air, I will let you know.
Well, let's go off air. Nick, we appreciate you jumping on to do this. Very good time. We're going to spend the next few weeks of this off season to sort out and find an official ombudsman. But very strong start for anybody who is interested in the job. This is the bar. Nick has set it. Nick has set a very high bar. Sir, it's been great to have you on the podcast and finally getting you on here, despite the fact that your Lord and Savior, Kalua Zikbe, did not live up to his conference play predictions.
There will be another one to follow. I'll have more predictions this coming year. So no worries.
Good night.
Thanks
and good luck.
Thanks for having me.
Cheers, buddy.